bombers struck London with a vengeance.
For miles around, the sky was a bright orange red. St. Paul's Cathedral, all around it, the flames were leaping up into the sky.
At this darkest of hours, Britain's Prime Minister recognised the huge importance of saving one building.
Winston Churchill immediately realised the symbolic significance and ordered that at all costs, St. Paul's must be saved.
As fire crews fought the flames all around, a photographer grabbed his camera.
He pressed the shutter and snap, he had a front page photograph, which has come for many people to sum up forever something of the spirit of the country they live in.
A quarter of a century later, Sir Winston Churchill was back in St. Paul's at the centre of a magnificent funeral ceremony. No one who saw it has ever forgotten the farewell the nation gave him.
It was so grand, but it was also so personal.
In the building he'd helped to save, the nation gave thanks for a man considered its saviour, and who's been revered ever since as a national hero.
When I saw his coffin, I thought, God, the man's gone. What the hell are we going to do now?
There were many in my parents' generation, the war generation, who worshipped Churchill. But times change. Is he any longer a great national hero? Or is he irrelevant?
Churchill was entranced by new ideas and new machines. He would be a terrific blogger and a self-googler of epic proportions, I expect.
No other commoner in modern times has had a send-off like the one we gave Churchill that bleak January day in 1965. And 50 years on, for better or for worse, we still live in the great man's shadow. The cult of celebrity has a shrine in central London. Here you can admire, embrace, or sometimes scorn the people whose tinsely presence we cannot avoid. For 200 years, Madame Tussauds has been making wax figures of the famous and the infamous. Today is the launch of their latest attraction, the actor Benedict Cumberbatch. As in real life, celebrity isn't restricted to the world of entertainment.
Of course, the politics section isn't the most popular bit of the attraction, but what's interesting is who makes it here and who doesn't. Of course, people like President Obama, there are up to 2,000 people a day posing for a photograph with him, and people like Mahatma Gandhi and other world leaders, of course they're here. British prime ministers, though, well, there's the current one, and the man who swears blind he doesn't want his job, and there's Mrs. Thatcher. There is no sign, though, of any other British politician here. Intriguing, with one exception, and that one exception is Winston Churchill.
The first figure that we made of Churchill was put into the exhibition in 1908, yes.
That's almost unrecognisable as the Churchill that we know from the wartime.
Yes, he's quite unique in the sense that few people actually relate to the young image of him, but of course he was young.
So one way or another, he's been on display here for over 100 years.
Yes, well, we modelled Churchill 7 times through his lifetime. What we would do is we would refigure him every time there was a marked moment in his life. The last portrait he did while he was still alive was at his easel and painting, and this was put out the year he died.
What's the one on display now?
The one on display now is him in the height of the 40s.
And that is because of all the impressions of Churchill and that very, very long life. That is the strongest one that people identify.
Exactly.
So, 50 years after we laid him away with all the pomp the nation could summon, Churchill remains almost as real as his latter-day imitators. Call someone Churchillian, and most think you're paying them a deep compliment.
He's colossal. He's the Everest of British politicians. He's miles bigger in scale, in construction, than any politician, other politicians that I've studied. I mean, Margaret Thatcher, the lot of them, they're absolutely dwarfed by Churchill. And if you look at what Churchill achieved every day, it is absolutely mind-boggling. He was running on a different kind of petrol.
Just because we get around. By the mid-60s, as Churchill's life was drawing to a close, another Britain was being born. The new country was pushy, noisy, and brash. It looked forward to fun, not back to past glories. Youth culture rejected the rule of fools in old-style hats and coats. Why be grand when you could be cool?
In the course of his long career, Churchill had opposed votes for women and been pretty sceptical, to say the least, about immigration. By the time of his death in 1965, the permissive society was already being born. I wonder what he'd have made of the miniskirts on the King's Road, the counterculture, the rise of multiculturalism. I suspect that he'd have harumphed. But the irony is, of course, that by leading the fight against fascism, he'd given us all the chance to choose what sort of society we wanted to live in.
As Churchill's physical strength ebbed in the last years of his life, he fought the black dog of depression by taking breaks abroad with friends and family. In June 1962, Churchill was staying at the Hotel de Paris in Monte Carlo when he fell from his bed and broke his hip. His private secretary, Anthony Montagu Brown, and his granddaughter Celia were sent for.
We got to the hospital and he looked awful, absolutely awful. And Grandpapa just dismissed all the medical people in the room, whether they were doctors or nurses. He said, would they all go out of the room, please? And he turned to Anthony and said, I want to die in England. You'll make sure of that, won't you? And Anthony said, yes. And then Grandpapa said, you promise? And he said, I promise. Anyway, the next day, Harold Macmillan sent an ambulance plane from the RAF. My grandfather was on the stretcher bed in the middle of the, I suppose, the body of the aeroplane, and I was sitting on a chair next to him, and we were just holding his hand and hoping and praying he'd make it.
After 54 days in Middlesex Hospital, he was coming out and returning home. When has there been a man to compare with Winston Churchill? And what a crush there was to be among the first to see him. The old warrior was about again after the toughest fight of his life.
The ambulance began the short journey across London to Hyde Park Gate, where waiting crowds cheered him home. Prime Minister Harold Macmillan's decision to order the RAF to fly home his ailing predecessor wasn't entirely the spontaneous act of kindness that it seemed to many of the crowds outside Churchill's London home here. In fact, the Air Force had been working for years on a secret plan to bring Churchill back home. The only thing was that Operation Hope Not, as it was called, didn't envisage returning a sick former Prime Minister, but a dead body. The fact was that behind the scenes and without Churchill knowing, the government had been preparing for what they might do when he died.
In this file here, there had actually been an enormous amount of planning. It starts in January 1958, a full 7 years before the state funeral. And what you're looking at here are the very first plans drawn up by Anthony Montagu Brown, Sir Winston Churchill's private secretary, working with his counterparts in the Cabinet Office and in the palace.
This is almost exactly 7 years before he died. Why had they started then?
Well, of course, you have to remember that Churchill is already well into his 80s by this point. His health is starting to fail. And I think there is a fear amongst his inner circle that the worst could happen at any time from now on.
Did the family know that these plans were being made?
What we've got here is a wonderful handwritten letter from the summer of 1958. So we're still very early on. And what you're seeing here is Anthony Montagu Brown writing what must have been a very difficult letter to Clementine Churchill, Lady Spencer Churchill.
The Queen's intimated that if it is in accordance with the wishes of the family, there should be plans for Sir Winston to have a state funeral. It is suggested there should be a lying in state in Westminster Hall, followed by the service at St. Paul's. This is thought to be more fitting than Westminster Abbey, as St. Paul's has the precedence of comparatively recent great national heroes such as Nelson and the Duke of Wellington.
So suddenly this is becoming a huge enterprise. And it's at that point, of course, that the operation is given its code name, which is Operation Hope Not.
And then he ends saying, "I'm bidden to seek your views. You will realise how I hate distressing you with all this, but I know you will understand the desirability, far off may it be." So this is the first she knows that her husband is going to be buried effectively by the state. A state funeral at St. Paul's was a way of the nation saying thank you. And in the entire 20th century, Winston Churchill was the only commoner to be given this honour. What was less known, though, was that the Dean of St. Paul's some years previously had suggested he actually be buried in the very building he'd fought so hard to save from German bombers.
In the crypt beneath the great cathedral are memorials to many of the admirals and generals who led British forces during World War II. A Valhalla filled with the commanders whom Churchill had known at the height of their powers.
It's the tombs of the Duke of Wellington and Admiral Lord Nelson which dominate this place. There had been talk of Churchill having his own tomb here too, but he had other plans.
Churchill had fallen in love with Chartwell, a country house in Kent, in the 1920s. Over the next two decades, he made it his family home. A day away from Chartwell, he said, was a day wasted.
It's the place he most loved in the whole world. It was his headquarters for everything that he did, for painting, writing, for seeing his political friends, for everything. Chartwell was his headquarters. He loved it. He loved the garden. He was, he said, at peace in my own habitation.
Scarcely a weekend would go by at Chartwell without Churchill surrounded by his children, grandchildren, and his beloved animals.
Chartwell, I think, meant everything in the world to him. He felt that the burdens of the world were lifted from his shoulders when he went through those gates at Chartwell.
Like most politicians, Churchill wasn't overburdened with a sense of modesty. Yet he told his family that when he died, he didn't want a grand funeral with mausoleums and monuments. He wanted his last mortal remains to end up on the lawn.
Churchill cared enough about mortality to change his will several times after the war. But he never wavered in his desire to be cremated and to have his ashes strewn at Chartwell.
Specifically, he wanted his ashes scattered near the croquet lawn, next to the graves of his dogs, Rufus I and Rufus II.
In the 1930s, the period known as his wilderness years, Churchill had spent much time here at his desk at Chartwell, warning of the rise of Nazi Germany and the need for rearmament. Chartwell looked out across unmistakably English countryside, and it was in the skies above the Kentish Weald that young pilots fought the Battle of Britain.
Never in the field of human conflict was so much owed by so many to so few.
Churchill, the new Prime Minister, rallied the nation during the Blitz, encapsulating an idea of a people standing alone and refusing to surrender.
If the British Empire and its Commonwealth last for 1,000 years, men will still say, this was their finest hour.
In time and at huge cost, survival became victory. With that came pride in being a nation willing, if necessary, to stand alone. Bloody-minded, perhaps, but certain.
What kind of a people do they think we are? Is it possible they do not realize that we shall never cease to persevere against them until they have been taught a lesson which they and the world will never forget?
It was Churchill's genius to find the words that spoke for England at a very, very difficult time in its history. How resonant those words are that 50 years after his death, they still seem to conjure up an idea of who we are.
It is this identification of man and nation that gives Churchill his unique status. But the country he led has become a very different place.
He would have been depressed by the way Britain seemed to have been reduced. He said towards the end of his life, you know, I've worked so hard and achieved so much, only in the end to achieve nothing. I think he was basically fishing for compliments. But I think he did regret the loss of empire, the loss of India and all the rest of it. But I think he would have been very, very amazed by how people live today.
But as far as young people are concerned, he doesn't mean anything much nowadays.
I don't think that's true. I think that, yes, I mean, you read the statistics, oh, yes, everybody thinks he's the dog in the church, in the insurance advertisement. I think that actually he's a very powerful figure in the imaginations of many young people because they identify him as the guy who won the war and beat Adolf Hitler.
As he approached his death, Churchill told a friend that he had no appetite for life and that when it comes to dying, I shall not complain. He knew his reputation rested on his wartime premiership, particularly 1940. Much of the remainder of his life was a catalogue of failure. His misgivings were expressed in a story he wrote, which was discovered only after his death. In 1947, Churchill was painting here in his studio at Chartwell. He was trying to do a copy of that portrait of his father, Randolph Churchill, when suddenly he became aware of another presence in the room. And there, sitting in that red leather armchair, he said that he saw his father. His father asked his son, what had happened in Britain since he died at the end of the 19th century, and Winston Churchill gave him a potted history of the first few decades of the 20th century, the Boer War, income tax, the First World War. But he hadn't got as far as the Second World War when his father interrupted him, saying, I'm surprised you didn't go into politics. You could have done something to help. You might even have made a name for yourself. And then, just like that, he was gone.
With no time to talk of his wartime achievements, Churchill's dream highlighted a deep sense of unease over a troubled relationship with a father who had died when Churchill was only 20.
I think that he was in the back of his, the very back of his consciousness, was the thought of his father and how he could have pleased him, was with him all his life.
That's a remarkable thing, though, by the time you knew him, he was into his 70s, that should still be present in his mind even then.
Yes.
That's remarkable.
I think it was an overwhelming affection, and just, maybe it was also an anxiety that he hadn't done enough to please him.
There's little doubt that this troubled relationship with his dead father would remain with Churchill till the end. As an old man, he changed his will again. Instead of having his ashes scattered beside his pets at Chartwell, he decided he'd be buried at Bladen in Oxfordshire, in the shadow of Blenheim Palace, where he'd been born. Significantly, the place he chose to be buried was next to the grave of his father.
In the last 5 years, I'd say he was definitely getting tired and probably tired of life.
How did that show itself?
Well, he would sit looking into the fire and he would sit looking at the view. I mean, he was quiet and then suddenly he might, you know, he would be more energetic. But on the whole, this was that the last few years were definitely quiet, peaceful and really contemplative, I suppose. I mean, he had his 90th birthday party only 6 weeks before, and we all knew that this couldn't go on much longer.
By the lights of modern health Puritans, it was astonishing he had gone on for so long, but his life was testament to the benefits of luxury. In 1911, Churchill had co-founded The Other Club, where over the years in this room, he indulged his enormous capacity for work and for pleasure, insulated from a changing Britain by decorative panelling, silverware and fine food.
So much of Churchill's life seems to come straight from the pages of an Edwardian ripping yarn. He'd fought on the northwest frontier, he'd taken part in one of the last British Empire cavalry charges, he'd been a prisoner of the Boers, and then later he'd been in the trenches during the First World War. Politically, he had been both Prime Minister and he had been an MP over 6 decades.
As 1964 drew to a close, Churchill had finally given up his seat in Parliament. But he wasn't going to give up every pleasure in life.
Churchill had a gargantuan appetite. He's reckoned to have smoked over 250,000 cigars, and who knows how many countless gallons of champagne he drank. His diary for early 1965 includes an engagement for dinner in this room. It was an appointment he was unable to keep.
On Sunday, January the 10th, 1965, Churchill suffered a stroke at his London home, from which doctors believed he was unlikely to recover. It wasn't long before the news leaked out, and in the following days, Hyde Park Gate was under siege from both press and well-wishers. Among the family visiting that January were Churchill's son Randolph and his son Winston, as well as Churchill's daughter Mary Soames and her 16-year-old son Nicholas.
I remember it very, very well. It was an extraordinary period of time, and my siblings and I came to say goodbye to him. Hyde Park Gate was absolutely crammed with people, very immensely quiet and respectful. And it wasn't a sad death, really. We couldn't be sorry for him.
Throughout the vigil, Lord Moran, Churchill's doctor, provided regular bulletins about his patient, who was now close to death.
After a restless start, Sir Winston has had a peaceful day. But he has lost ground.
We sort of gathered round the bed. I remember that my grandmother was sitting on one side holding his hand with the doctor beside her, and Randolph and Winston were the other side, and my two aunts and I, we all knelt at the bottom of the bed. And he was breathing, and there was a sigh, and yeah, it was just literally without one noticing, no one knew when actually the difference between life and death. But my grandmother turned to Lord Moran and said, "Has he gone?" And he said, "Yes."
We announced the death of Sir Winston Churchill. The announcement came from 28 Hyde Park Gate a few minutes ago. It said that Sir Winston died shortly after 8 o'clock this morning.
Here in the Soviet Union, the Soviet government is sending condolences to Sir Winston's family and to the British government.
Australian regard for Churchill's sheer greatness, courage and vision as wartime leader and post-war prophet.
In accordance with the tradition of state funerals, Churchill's body was placed on a catafalque in Westminster Hall. He would lie in state for 3 days before the funeral. Over 300,000 people came to pay their respects.
My mother said, you know, from the moment his coffin left Hyde Park Gate to come here to lie in state, she said to us, he doesn't belong to us anymore. He belongs to the nation.
It was, above all, intensely moving. I suppose principally because I'd known him. I felt a very close connection there. But also it was the grandeur and the ceremony of Westminster Hall with the soldiers with their arms round the coffin. I went many times just to pay my respects.
The people waiting tried to keep warm by stamping their feet, huddling ever closer into their overcoats and scarves and blankets. Some of them had to wait 2.5 hours. Later, a few snow...
Reporting for the BBC was a young journalist, Martin Bell.
I just described the size of the crowd and the quietness and the sense of purpose, and they were going to stay there for as long as it took.
What was it that they were turning out for? Obviously it was a funeral, but was it something more than that?
I think they were turning out because they recognised the passing of someone very special in the life of the nation. I don't think the sort of revisionist historians had really chipped in by then, and I think people had probably forgotten the wilderness years and the errors of judgment and all the things that now are in every history. We just remembered the passing of a very great man, and this was the last time to pay tribute to him. I would have thought that that event, the funeral, the lying in state, the great crowds, they represented the passing of the old Britain.
General, salute! Present! Fight!
On the 30th of January 1965, the coffin of the man who had led Britain through the war emerged from Westminster Hall. 7,000 servicemen waited for the start of the biggest procession London had witnessed since the Queen's coronation 12 years earlier. Commanding the bearer party carrying the coffin was a young lieutenant, Anthony Mather.
The bearer party consists of 8 bearers, with the tallest at the rear and the shortest in the front. And on this occasion, because it was a state occasion, there was a warrant officer in front, and I was bringing up the rear. giving the words of command and encouraging them to do as they were trained to do.
Among the bearers was Lance Sergeant Lincoln Perkins. The guardsmen were astonished by the weight of the burden on their shoulders.
The coffin, we were led to believe by the undertakers, was lead-lined. We all said, wow, we've not practiced with a weight like this before. It was just a surprise that he was so heavy.
There have been funeral processions before. There have been state funerals of...
Narrating the television coverage for the BBC was the veteran broadcaster Richard Dimbleby.
There has not been, I think, in the whole history of our land, a state funeral or an occasion which has touched the hearts of people quite as much as this one is doing today.
At 9:45, Big Ben chimed to mark the start of the procession to St. Paul's. The bell would remain silent for the rest of the day. There had been 7 years of planning beforehand. The state funeral was organized in 6 days.
I marched behind the coffin with my father and my younger brother, Jeremy. And I always remember Jeremy was 12, I think, and he was the only one who didn't wear a top hat. He wasn't old enough to wear a top hat. And it was a freezing cold day, and I thought he must have frozen alive.
Strangely enough, you are very focused on what is going on in front of you, and your eyes are not swiveling around, seeing too much. But it was patently obvious that every side of the road, the crowds were 10, 12 deep, very somber and very respectful of the coffin as it passed them.
Just marching down Whitehall, you saw these extraordinary faces. I mean, I've never seen such collective grief. And of course, people 10, 20 deep on the pavement the whole way. I mean, it was just sort of heartbreaking, really. It was just so moving.
My sister and I were sitting in the carriage together, and you could practically touch the people if you'd wanted to, and you could see their faces. I mean, it was extraordinary. I mean, you could see the tears pouring down their faces. You could see, I mean, the emotion that we saw on that journey, I mean, it was true, raw emotion. And I mean, not just tears trickling, I mean, really, I mean, with real anguish on their faces.
Over 3,000 people had been invited to St. Paul's for the funeral service. 111 countries would be represented, including 5 monarchs, 6 heads of state, and 16 prime ministers. The family wanted the funeral to have as personal a feel as possible. So a seat was found for the woman who baked Churchill's birthday cake every year, another for Odette Paul Roger, the woman whose company had made so much of the many gallons of champagne that Churchill had drunk, and another because he enjoyed building brick walls at Chartwell and carried a union card, for a representative of the National Union of Bricklayers. Churchill wasn't just Britain's hero. International statesmen like former President Eisenhower and President de Gaulle came too, recognizing Churchill's role in saving the Western world and democracy. Churchill's comrades from the country's finest hour tottered in too. The politicians who'd schemed and dreamed that one day they'd replace him, and the unlucky ones who did and were found wanting. The hour had made the man, and the hour, thank God, has not come again.
It was from this bunker deep beneath the streets of London that Churchill commanded armies, navies and aircrew all over the world. It was decisions made here and implemented here that determined the future of the world. When those dignitaries processed into St Paul's Cathedral in January 1965, they were paying tribute to the leadership of this country at a time when the rest of the world critically depended upon it. But have the events of the early 1940s ever really been forgotten? When we venerate Churchill, do we, in a sense, expect to maintain forever the position at the top of international affairs as we had when he was Prime Minister?
Doesn't he represent an idea of Britain in the world that is actually profoundly unhelpful?
Actually, I think that Churchill's vision of Britain's role in the world is the most valid and useful guide for how we should think of ourselves. He wanted, obviously, Britain to have a close relationship with the former imperial countries of the Commonwealth, sure. But he also thought that Britain should be deeply intertwined with the United States. But he also thought that it was our destiny to be involved in what took place in Europe. Winston Churchill was one of the founders of the idea of the European Union. He was one of the great campaigners. And that vision of Britain as the centre of these three interconnecting sets, Europe, the Commonwealth, America, that's still a very powerful and attractive vision of how this country ought to position ourselves.
Back again at St Paul's Cathedral in a moment, and we'll see the first arrival of members of our own royal family. The Queen, with her, the Prince of Wales, who has come from school at Gordonstoun for this day, and of course, His Royal Highness Prince Philip, Duke of Edinburgh, in his uniform as Admiral of the Fleet, passing the gorgeous tabards of the heralds, the darker greatcoats of the household cavalry.
The bearer party, now carrying the coffin from the gun carriage to the cathedral, were about to face potentially huge public embarrassment.
We had difficulties occasionally, particularly on the steps of St Paul's. That was really the worst time. And we brought in on that occasion two swingmen at the back who helped to keep it steady on the shoulders, so not letting it slip downwards.
Just ahead of the bearer party was Lord Attlee, the former Labour Prime Minister, who'd insisted on attending the funeral against medical advice.
Halfway up the second flight of stairs when Lord Attlee stumbled.
This is what, going into St Paul's?
Yes, going into St Paul's, and we had to come to a stop. And it did actually slide off the two front shoulders of the two bearers. And we was very lucky that we got the two gentlemen at the back who were pushers, what we call pushers, who pushes up.
What went through your mind?
Oh, tell it to Richard Churchill, don't worry, sir, we'll look after you. Of course, I was really talking to myself, but apparently I was talking out loud, because you could actually feel him sliding off the shoulders. If we had dropped him, we'd have been, I don't know what would have been, very embarrassing, but we didn't.
And in a huge oaken coffin, surmounted by Union Jack, the body of Winston Churchill, is borne for his funeral service into the great Mother Church of the Commonwealth.
High up in the cathedral that morning was the St Paul's bell ringer, Jim Phillips.
We went up into the ringing chamber where we ring the bells, made ourselves comfortable, and then we went along the triforium to a gallery under the dome to watch the funeral from there. And it was quite interesting going or we passed a garden shed, and it was dear old Richard Dimbleby in this garden shed doing the commentary from there.
So the setting is complete as the sentences come towards their end.
The service was... it wasn't harrowing, because it was just magnificent, really.
It was very, very moving and overwhelming, these great hymns. It was so grand, but it was also so personal. There was Winston Churchill in his coffin, and he was with us. I mean, there was a great sense of his presence at the ceremony.
Brethren, we are assembled here to join in prayer on the occasion of the burial of a great man who has rendered memorable service to his country and to the cause of freedom.
Of course one cried, I suppose, but we were swept along on this sort of tidal wave of splendor and splendid grief. The most wonderful, wonderful music I've ever heard anywhere in my entire life. And when the last post was played, I mean, you know, there wasn't a person in that, in St. Paul's Cathedral, who wasn't just standing bolt upright. It was just extraordinary.
Good morning.
Good morning, sir.
Nice to see you. Morning. Thank you for coming. How does it feel to be back?
Well, yes, it's all coming back, actually.
There were two trumpeters playing at the funeral that day.
Yeah, for what I can remember, anyway.
Peter Wilson and Basil King haven't seen each other in 50 years, since playing together here at St. Paul's.
Did you feel this was a special occasion?
Oh, this was definitely special. Definitely special.
Did you get a sense you were being part of history?
No, I didn't. No, no, no. All I was worried about had been knocking knees.
After Peter had finished the last post, Basil answered with Reveille.
It's the very easiest thing in the world to crack a note playing these type of trumpets, as people say, isn't it? It's easy, easy to crack a note on there. And these were superb. And I thought, well, mine's got to be exactly the same. So I think I fixed my eye on something on the wall and got the nod to go, and there it was. It went very well, thankfully.
There were lots of people in the congregation that day among the mourners, particularly family members, who cried when they heard you two play. Did you get any sense of how people were reacting to hearing you play?
The last post always gets them, doesn't it, really? You know, it doesn't matter where you are or what funeral, the last post, they start to cry, yeah.
Muffled bells of St. Paul's, rung by the ancient society of college youths, the bell ringers of the cathedral, ring out now high above the church over London.
Oh, it's tense, very tense. There's an atmosphere. An atmosphere of sadness. This great man had gone. And when we pulled the bells off to peel them, every sinew and muscle was strained, and my legs were shaking, and the world was listening to us. The focus was on St. Paul's at that particular hour. it was one of those things we had to do for the man, and I think we did it very well.
From St. Paul's, the gun carriage travelled to Tower Bridge, where the man who'd been first Lord of the Admiralty in two world wars was carried onto the Haven Gore, a Port of London Authority launch now waiting at Tower Pier. The state funeral was about to end, and the private ceremony for the family would shortly begin. River traffic on the Thames had been stopped for an hour as the Haven Gore pulled out and headed upstream.
What was the Haven Gore's role in the funeral?
Well, this was the final part of the state funeral. It was moving the coffin from Tower Pier up the river to Waterloo Station, a journey of some sort of 15, 20 minutes.
And this, as the plaque says, is where the coffin was.
That's right.
Was the coffin alone on the boat?
No, there was a bearer party to obviously carry the coffin on board and off. There was also the chief mourners, so that was Lady Churchill and the immediate members of her family in this cabin here.
Above the Haven Gore that day, as if from nowhere, roared 16 Lightning aircraft, a tribute from RAF Fighter Command.
Of the many emotional scenes on that charged day, one sight which really stuck in the minds of those who saw it was the spectacle of the cranes of the Port of London lowering their jibs as the barge passed. It seemed a spontaneous gesture of respect from a people in a part of Britain that had really suffered from Hitler's bombers during the Blitz.
We were all undone by the cranes dipping in salute to his coffin. That was just, I mean, that undid us all, really.
What an emotional sight that was, to finish off. So everybody's paying their respects by doing a half-mast crane. Amazing sight. Marvellous. Tear to the eye.
Those Thames cranes have long since gone, but one of the workers from the time remembers the docker's gesture somewhat differently.
You know the scene at the funeral when the dock cranes lower their jibs?
Yeah.
Talk to anyone who watched the television coverage in particular, that's the thing they remember.
Yeah.
And they all found it very, very moving.
Yeah.
Mm. Do you find it moving?
Not really, because I know what happened.
What had happened?
They didn't like Churchill. Well, I'd say they didn't like him. I think I can speak for most of them. They didn't like him. And when they were asked to do it, the atmosphere was no, but then when they were paid to do it, because we didn't work Saturday afternoons, they wouldn't have been there.
So that was not a spontaneous gesture?
No
of...
way. No way.
They were paid to do it?
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
What was the feeling among the dockers about the men who were prepared to operate the cranes then?
I know that there was a lot of arguments and rows about it, and the atmosphere seemed to be, or the attitude seemed to be, if you respected the man, you'd have done it for nothing. If you didn't respect him, you shouldn't have done it at all. The atmosphere was that Churchill wasn't a working class person, he wasn't a working man's representative at all, absolutely. I mean, I remember going to school with holes in my shoes and bits of cardboard in, and we used to see him with a great big cigar in one end, sometimes a drink in the other. It just didn't associate with us at all.
But it was a very moving gesture.
It was, yeah.
Were you moved by it?
I was, to be honest, I was. Oh, even though, you know...
You didn't like church.
No, I didn't like church.
You were moved by the gesture?
I was moved by that, yeah. I was moved by the old funeral. But I didn't like him at all.
Churchill had certainly been no friend of militant trade unionism and had even sent in the army against strikers. But he had led the fight against German fascism. Churchill's coffin would leave London by train on the next stage of the journey towards the small Oxfordshire churchyard where he was to be buried that afternoon. Appropriately, the engine chosen to pull the funeral train was a steam locomotive from an earlier era. It was named Winston Churchill. The engine has been restored by a group of railway buffs in Hampshire to mark the anniversary of Churchill's death. At Waterloo Station, a new bearer party, made up of soldiers from Churchill's old cavalry regiment, bore his coffin onto the train waiting at Platform 11. Just after 1:30 in the afternoon, the funeral train and mourners pulled out. It was the start of a 70-mile journey which would take 2 hours to reach the tiny station of Hamborough, close to the churchyard at Bladen.
The moment that we left Waterloo, we saw so many people, thousands and thousands of people along the line, you know, in some of the strangest places, even in the countryside, they were in the fields, all along the line. And that was the most telling thing I felt personally about it. But the other thing was all the old soldiers, all in their battle dress, saluting as that train went by. Quite something. Never forget that.
I remember going down in the train to Bladen. There was a lock keeper, I remember, with all his medals up, standing there saluting.
At Bladen, they had been preparing for the burial from the moment 6 days earlier when they first received news of Churchill's death. The passing of a historic figure merited an ancient village rite.
When you heard the news, you came across to the church and tolled the bell. Why did you do that?
Well, it used to be the old-fashioned way that when anybody passed away in the village, you used to go and toll the bell, and you used to toll the bell 3 threes for a man and 2 threes for a lady. And anybody in the village then knew that somebody had passed away and it was either a man or a lady.
And so was it because you thought that Churchill belonged to the village or what?
Well, I thought it was a respect to let people know that Winston had died, you know. Because we always knew that he was going to be buried here, because that's what he always said he was coming back to with his mother and father.
For the day of the funeral, Lady Churchill had asked for the press and cameras to keep away from Bladen. Only villagers were allowed to witness the arrival of the coffin for the private burial.
Now, where's this picture? This must be one of the very last photographs taken at the funeral.
That is. That was hit right here where we're standing. That is there, because there's a house there.
Here's the coffin coming down.
Yeah, it came down here and stopped here. Yeah.
So what, it's taken from that window
taken
up there?
Taken from that window, and this is the wall that's coming down here.
This is the coffin actually going into the churchyard,
isn't it? That's right. I don't know how I got them, but different people used to give you different photographs.
And then these little photographs here, these tiny, tiny ones, must be the last photographs of the lot, I suppose.
That's right, as they went from here to through the lych gate.
Into the churchyard, yeah.
Yeah.
Were you very moved that day?
Yes, I was. Yes, I was.
I bet you were, actually.
It was the most beautiful day. Beautiful, beautiful, ice-cold day. And he was committed, with his whole family standing around him. And as the coffin was lowered into the grave, a Spitfire flew right over his head. I've never forgotten that.
So the journey that had taken him all over the world ended in an English country churchyard. There's no grand monument, no eternal flame, no ringing declaration, just a stone slab inscribed with his name and that of his wife who joined him a few years later. On that icy January day back in 1965, more than a million people lined the London streets to honour the passing of a man who had stood firm when others might have buckled. He was just a human, mortal and fallible like the rest of us. But the people had seen in his spirit something they hoped to see in themselves. History isn't made by great men, but sometimes a man or woman may so come to express the spirit of the age that they become great. Winston Churchill was such a figure. He looked a bit like a bulldog, and when the nation needed it, he expressed the determination of a bulldog. Sure, he was a chancer, an egotist, a workaholic, and sometimes a bit of a charlatan. But in this age of political miniatures, there is no one who can hold a candle to him. For the sake of the nation, we must hope that the old cliche about never seeing his like again isn't true, because one day we may need his like. But in the 50 years since his death, there has been no sign of such a figure.